Hey everyone, welcome back to my channel. I'm here to film a brand new video. This one's definitely different from the ones I normally do, or very different from the one I filmed before this, which was a get ready with me on how to do this look here. So if you want to see that, I don't know if it's going up before or after this one, probably after, so hang in for that one, I guess. But today I'm going to be doing the story time on something very tragic that happened to my family. So yeah, it's definitely heavier and it's a wild story and it's kind of a long one. So I'm going to have my phone, here to help me, keep this thing going so it doesn't go all over the place. And I guess we can just start with it. As you can assume from the title, it's a lot. So I just wanted to throw out there that this is 100% a true story. It happened a little over 2 years ago to my family. I've tried to film videos on this before, but it hasn't always gone the best, or I tried to film it and then couldn't and all this. Another disclaimer is that I'm probably not gonna be too down in this video, I guess. I'll be more upbeat considering what this story's about. And that's just because I've told this story so many times. I've told this over the 2 years since it happened. Oh, Kirky's in here, that's why my door opened. Here she is,
coming to say hi.
You can't see her. Or maybe you can, there she is. But yeah, this is 100% true story. I'll try to, I'm not gonna be too down just because I've had time to accept it and heal from it and get through it, and so is the rest of my family. So that's why this is gonna be pretty the way I'm gonna tell the story is gonna make it seem like it didn't happen, but I'll put in pictures to prove. So there are a few details I want you to know before I really dive into it. So I live in rural Montana, or we lived in rural Montana at the time of this. We live out of town, so we're not in the city district. And to get into town, it's 10 to 15 minutes if you're us, but if you're someone who doesn't live out here and you're trying to find it out here, it will take you 20 to 30 minutes because you're following the speed limits and stuff. On that note, there is only a sheriff out here every once in a while, and even then there's still 5 miles from us or 6 miles from us, where town is 3 or 4 miles from the point where he normally camps out. So there's only a sheriff out here once or twice a year and catches us speeding coming there, but we're fine. Yeah, we've been caught. Not saying speeding's good, you shouldn't do it, but when you live this far out of town and you live on private roads, yeah. The next thing is we have some really good family friends. My parents are friends with these people. I didn't talk to them first about this, so I don't know if I should say their name or not, so I decided to refer to them as the Bernsteins, the Bernsteins Bears or the Bernstein Bears. So that's how I'm gonna refer to them, as Mr. and Mrs. Bernstein. And then another thing is my dad is a orthopedic surgeon, so he's had lots of patients over the years. We've lived here for about 20 years now. So basically my entire life. Lived here for about 20 years. He's had patients throughout all that time. And orthopedics is your bones. So if you break your back, you're gonna have to put hardware in it to help keep your bones together, basically, and keep everything in line, is my spliced version of how that works. I mean, I know it's not entirely true, but you get the gist. So I'm gonna also give this to you from multiple perspectives. I'm gonna start with mine, and then I'm gonna go to my mom's, and then I'm gonna film with everyone else's. So this happened the weekend before, it's the Monday before spring break. So we had Monday and Tuesday of school, and then spring break started Wednesday. And I was a senior in high school at this time, and the high school is 25-30 minutes away. So basically, Monday morning started like any other day. I woke up very late for school. Or not late for school, but like later than I should have woken up, you know what I mean? To like get ready and get everything in time. So I woke up, and I had just gotten a new laptop for my birthday like a few months prior. And I kind of like looked at my laptop and then I was like, you know what, I'm going to bring it to school with me today. Like that should be fun. So I'm going to bring that to school. So I grabbed my laptop, got in my car. And another note is my car is always loaded with just crap, like tons and tons of clothes. I did dance and like all sorts of like activities where I needed changes of clothes, like gymnastics, coaching and stuff. So tons of clothes are always in my car. And for some reason, my ski coat was too, which is strange. But anywho, so I go throughout my day and then I have choir right before lunch. So two of my friends at choir are like, oh, what are you doing for lunch? And I was kind of like, you know what? I think I might go home for lunch because I had an open period right after my lunch. So my lunch was like 2 hours long or like hour and a half, 2 hours long. So I had a super long lunch. So I was like, you know what? I think I might go home for lunch. And then got in my car and I was saying that. And then I was like, you know what? Nah, I'm going to go to like this local hibachi place and get some fried rice. So that's what I ended up doing. Come back. They're in class helping out with the classes that I normally help out with when the assistant associate principal comes into the class and says, Maddie DB, I need to pull you, like, I need you to come with me to my office. And I was like, you know, like, oh my God, am I in trouble? Like, I was a nerd in high school pretty much. I like didn't have many friends, didn't like do too much. I could be pretty like loud and boisterous if I wanted to be, but like for the most part, I pretty much like stayed in my choir area, and that's where I was crazier than everywhere else. I didn't do that. So she was wanting me there, and I was like, uh-oh. And she's like, don't worry, it's nothing bad. So then in my mind, I'm like, ooh, did I get a reward? Like, am I winning something? Like, what's happening? So I get into our office, sit down, and my sister's already there. I'm like, or no, they're calling my sister. So I'm like, huh. My sister sits down, and in my mind, I'm like, oh my God, are Allie and I in trouble? Did we post something? Were we mean to someone? Like, I was just racking my brain trying to figure out why the hell I was in that office in the first place. So she looks at us and goes, or the SRO is there, which is the cop guy for our school, the policeman, he's like resident, and he deals with a lot of stuff like, you know, bullying and like threatening situations. So that's why I was freaking out a bit, because he was sitting there as well as the associate's principal, as well as the other associate principal. So I'm in there with my sister, two associate principals, and the SRO, and I'm panicking. And then they're like, there was an issue at home. Your mom was held at gunpoint, and that's all that we know. And she's safe. She's at the Bernstein's house. The Bernstein's. And you just need to get your stuff and go meet them there, and that's all we know. We don't have anything other information for you. I'm sorry. We'll let you know if we do before, like, you leave. So Allie and I climb all the stairs, and the first thing that went in my head when I heard that was like, he burned her house down. Like, her house is gone. And I was like, no. They didn't tell us anything about that. Like, why would you think that? So it's like, you know what? Never mind. I'm not going to say it to my sister because Allie was crying. So we went up to her class, got all her things, went to my class, got all my things. And in my head, I just kept thinking that. But since my sister was crying, I was like, it's fine. Like, it'll be okay. Whatever. So I was like, it seems like a big deal, but it also seems like it worked out okay. So that's fine. So what we ended up was doing was I drove Allie in my car to the house, and we get to their house, and my dad comes out and he's crying. And my dad never cries. Like, I think that was the first time I'd ever seen him cry, either that or it was the second time. And he was bawling. I've never seen my dad, like, crying like I cry. Like, when I cry, I'm like, you know, like that. And I saw him like that, and I was like, oh my God. And he came and he hugged us, and he said, a bad man tried to kill your mommy and burned our house down. And that's basically what happened to my side of the story. So, like, that was, wow, that was really bad, because we, you know, Ali and I at that point officially just totally lost it. Yeah, but before we dive into the after, now we're gonna go back to my mom's perspective. So here's like, here's what happened. So Sunday night, or Sunday midday, hold on, let me see if I'm still recording. My mom got a call from this person. His name was David Heron. I'm not gonna like censor his name because he's a horrible person and he's dead, so no censorship on that. He called her and said, hey, I'm one of Mike's patients. Mike's my dad. I operated on you. I mean, your dad operated on me a few years. Your dad. God, I'm butchering this. Your husband operated on me like a few years ago. I think it was like close to 10 years too. It was ridiculous. He's like, and my daughters made this woodworking furniture piece to thank him for fixing me up all those years ago. So I was just wondering if I could bring it by the house the next day. And my mom was like, heck yeah. Like, you know, this isn't something that was weird or out of the blue. Like, people, you know, patients give my dad gifts all the time. Normally, with, you know, old ranchers give him like hunting access on their lands and like, or like fishing access, because he likes to do that. So this wasn't anything too out of the ordinary, basically. Like, it wasn't anything to raise alarms. So my mom said, yeah, sure, like, I'll be home around this time, kind of right on like 10, 11 lunchtime. And that was that. So the next morning, she woke up, she was gonna go to CrossFit, so she took off all her wedding rings and stuff and left them upstairs, went to CrossFit, and then came home. Now, the way my house is set up, I think you can see, I'm gonna put an image here, and you can see there that there's a driveway that goes up kind of where the garage is. That's where my mom would normally park. She's in the middle part, but she actually parked in that loop in front. And this is actually pretty important. She parked in that loop in front because the guy said he had this furniture for her, so she thought, okay, I'll move my car out of the garage in case it's big. At this point, she had no idea what it was, so she thought it'd be best to just, like, make sure everything was out of the way. So she's there. He shows up. They're talking. Things are going well. He's saying how, like, thankful he was that my dad fixed his back and all this stuff. And then my mom was like, kind of like, okay, where is it? Like, something like that. And he's like, oh, the girls are coming with it. It's like in the trailer. They were behind me. They might have like gotten delayed or something, but they'll be here. And more time's going by. My mom makes some coffee and all this. And then like, he's been there for a long time, just talking with her. And it gets to the point where she's like, okay, where is it? And he's like, oh, they had a flat tire, like, blah, blah, blah. So he's just making all these excuses, and she just kind of has this guy in her house that she's talking with. He's, like, not really delivering on what he said he would. And all of a sudden, the conversation shifted. So from, like, the first half, and he was there for, like, an hour or two, the first half was talking about how grateful he was for my dad. And then the second half was talking about how my dad ruined his life. So he was saying that my dad ruined his life because he left hardware in his back or, like, in him when he did the surgery. But, you know, like, that's how orthopedic surgery works. You put something in to keep it together, you know what I mean? Or, like, replace something. So she was kind of trying to explain that to him, like, yeah, sometimes you have to leave it in there. Like, bones don't exactly grow back. Like, you have to leave it in there. It was going on like that until finally he crossed a line, and my mom was like, I need you to leave. And he stands up, walks over to her, and tries to hand her a pill and says, take this, it'll make things easier. And, you know, at this point, my mom's like, what? So she slapped it. I'm not going to censor my language at all this. She slapped it out of his hand and was like, get the fuck out of my house. And at that point, he started reaching behind him, you know, to pull out a gun, obviously, and he's going to pull it out, and my mom sees it, and she reacts, and, like, totally just disarms him, and the gun flies over. We have, like, a railing that goes next to, like, it's kind of like a blocker thing where the stairs go down, but it's to keep you from like falling over into the stairs. So it shoots over that railing and they fall down the stairs to the basement. The gun does, not my parents, my mom. So at that point they're grappling with each other until finally my mom's like, you know what? She tackles him to the ground. She has him pinned under her. She's like, you know, shaking him and is saying like, what the, you know, like it's, if you were to censor her dialogue at that moment, it'd be like, what the boo? Like, I can't believe you boo, you freaking, It's like just all beeped out, just swearing like a trucker, sailor, not trucker, and like shaking this guy and has him pinned down. So he's obviously taken back by this woman who just totally kicked the shit out of him. And he's there like, okay, just let me grab my keys, like, let me grab my, like, phone, keys, wallet, coat, I'll be right out of here, like, I'll leave. So he starts getting, and my mom's kind of like, okay, and he starts getting, like, it took her off guard, so he starts getting up, and he starts dragging her by her shirt to try and throw her down the stairs. And she sees this happening, so she lets him rip her, like, shirt off, and she runs out the front door, and down the stairs to where her car is parked perfectly in the loop. And she leaves her keys in her car. So that worked, like that was very convenient for her when he went downstairs to get the gun. So at this point my mom is driving and we have very minimal neighbors out here. There's a lot more now than there was 2 years ago. There's been crazy development in this area, but she's driving like neighbor to neighbor trying to see if anyone's home, skipped a few neighbors, knew they weren't, and then finally was like, oh, this one neighbor's an artist. So she goes to his house, pounding on the door, he opens the door and she just bolts in his house, gets straight to the phone and calls the police. And at that point she's watching from there, she can see our house, and she's like, he's still there, he's still at the house. Like, so the moment she called 911, there was a sheriff dispatched. And crazy as it is, this was the one in two times a year that there is a sheriff in this area. So that sheriff started heading out here. He was going to be the first one here. And that was just so freaking lucky that there was a cop there, because there normally isn't. Like I said, like twice a year at the most is when I see him. So he's heading out here. My mom's watching him. And then finally she's like, because he was at our house for a while. And then she's like, he's leaving the house. So, now I'm going to jump perspectives a little bit. So while she was on the phone with 911, she managed to get word to my dad. My dad works at the hospital, which if it is 15 to 20 minutes to get into town, it's another 15 to 20 minutes to get from that end of town to the end of the town the hospital's on. But our friends, the Bernsteins, have a company that's slightly out of town near our house. So my dad calls Mr. Bernstein and goes, Adrian's held at gunpoint, there's a fire, like, I don't know what to do. So he is rushing to our house at this point. But anyway, snapping back over. So my mom sees him going down the road, and at this point the sheriff has made it all the way to that road. So this guy's left our house and is coming down the dirt road to leave, to like get to the paved road and get out of here. As the sheriff is coming down this way, he sees the sheriff, gets you know, off put by it obviously, and turns into the neighbor's house. So this guy goes down to the neighbor's house and the sheriff kept going to my house. So no, the sheriff followed him there. At this point, so it was very important for me to mention we're not in the city district. So Mr. Bernstein got to the house before anyone else did and realized that it was on fire. He ran into our burning house trying to save my mom and see if she was there. And our house was going up for a long time before like a fire truck could come out here, because again, we're not in city, so it wasn't the city's responsibility to come out and help us. It was, I think, the volunteer fire truck. So that's another thing that kind of took forever. So while all that is going on, David Heron goes into the neighbor's house. He goes into the neighbor's house and says, call the police, call 911, the DB's house is on fire, trying to kind of save his ass, you know. So the neighbor calls 911, and he was like, what the heck? Like, there's just a guy in his house, but he thought it was a guy just trying to do a good thing. So he called the police, called the fire department, and turns around, and the neighbor isn't, I mean, not the neighbor, David Heron isn't there. Like, the weird guy who showed up in his house isn't there. So he kind of turns back around, and then he hears the click of a gun behind him. And then guy is holding him at gunpoint and says, get out. So the neighbor just kind of, like, walks out his house and, like, is just walking down the road, like, not sure what to do. And at that point, all of the police and sheriff units have converged on the neighbor's house. So all the neighbors, all the units are going down that driveway, and they actually arrest the neighbor. Because he's just walking down, like, I just got kicked out of my, held at gunpoint and kicked out of my own house. And the whole house was surrounded when David Heron went out to the back porch and shot himself on the neighbor's deck. So that happened. And I think I'm going to pull up my phone real quick to see if I missed anything. But yeah, so you can, I'm going to throw in some images here. There was a freaking video, I'll try to put in the video too, of the sheriff talking, and you can just see my house burning in the background. In my mind, I'm like, what an idiot, you know, like, what? So here are the images. This is what my house looked like right when it started, and then kind of going through the progression. Here's later as the fire was going. And then here is what all was left by the end. And it's hard for me because one of my biggest, like, I have a few pretty big fears. I mean, one of them's mirrors, don't ask me why. But there's that, and then I was always scared growing up that my house was gonna burn down. And that was brought on by a series of unfortunate events, that, like, book, movie, you know, all that. And I was always scared of my house burning down and just losing everything. And it happened. And I am so lucky that his plan didn't actually pan out. So when they went to his house, they found that he kept writing threatening letters to his neighbors, accusing them of spying on him, and had, like, a whole setup on how he was gonna murder both my parents and then possibly burn our house down to cover it up. So I was really lucky that my mom was such a hero and that his plan totally fell through on him because of my mom being such a badass hero. Yeah, because if she hadn't done that, like, she wouldn't be alive and my dad probably wouldn't have been alive. My sister and I would have been out and we would have come home to our house gone and our parents gone. And I'm so lucky and so thankful to my mom that that wasn't the case. But how it did pan out still freaking sucks, because there are horrible people out there. This guy, David Heron, had restraining orders held against him by his wife and children. And apparently he was bad-mouthing my dad all around town for years. And he definitely was messed up. Like, there was something not right in the head with him, and he just let it do this to him and tried to kill my parents over it, which sucks. I don't know if his plan included my sister and I in this, but I think his big plan was to either kill my mom in front of my dad or kill my dad in front of my mom to really send a message through to them. So glad that didn't happen. Although unfortunately what did happen is we lost 4 pets in this fire. Yeah, that sucks. We lost 2 cats, a hedgehog, and a dog. I'm gonna include, like, a slideshow at the end of this video commemorating them, because that really sucked. We did happen to, 3 dogs did survive. That's because they had an indoor-outdoor kennel away from the house, but all the animals inside the house didn't make it. And two of them were very young. So that was really sad. I mean, I just want to give thanks to the community of this town. You know who you are if you're watching this and you helped out in this situation, because the community was so great, like raising money to help us or donating their old clothes and like bringing us food, helping us with groceries. We stayed at the Bernstein's house, so I mean, sorry for not including your actual names, but thank you again so much for letting us stay at your house for a week afterwards. We got to stay at their house. They let us stay there. They cooked for us. They helped us. It was a hard time. Like, we all had to be given some sort of sleeping medication because we couldn't sleep at night, because that was all we could think about. You know, like, I don't think I've ever cried so much in a span of like a week. Like, it was just every day, all day, and it sucked so bad. My mom tried really hard to get my sister and I to go to school, and Allie and I handled it very differently. Like, if you want a video more in depth on how we got through this situation, I can do one. But if not, like, I'm just gonna give a little rundown here. Allie handled hers by just really trying to keep it in and like moving on, whereas I just tried to feel everything so I wouldn't like have any recurring emotions from this. The school was great. You know, kids from school were coming. They were asking my sister and I, they're like, what do you guys need right now? And like, normally I'd be like, oh no, it's okay, we're fine. But if something this traumatic happens, it's okay to accept help. You know, I was like, I need underwear. I need socks. Like, I don't have underwear or socks. I need some shoes. Like, I need shirts, bras, deodorant. Like, I just need like things, you know, that things that you don't think about every day that you need, like a new toothbrush, toothpaste, shampoos, conditioners. Like, lost a lot of makeup in that fire, but got a lot of makeup back, so I'm not too bummed out about that. Luckily, I had my laptop and a lot of clothes in my car. Again, the rest of my family wasn't so lucky. This is another thing that's like kind of looking on the bright side. Like, for my senior trip, my grandma was gonna bring me to Europe. My sister is a senior now and she's doing the same thing. But our passports were all lost, except for mine, because it was in my car for whatever weird reason. I had it in my car, and after that I'm like, yep, my passport's always staying in my wallet. They're like, that's not a safe place for it. And I was like, well, our house clearly isn't a safe place for it. So but like, lots of photos lost. It was definitely hard, especially being like a senior about to graduate, have a graduation party, and having no photos. You know how like everyone for their senior year, their big graduation, has all these photo slideshows or like photo boards put out and all that? Like, it was hard because we just lost all of our photos, so we didn't have many of them, so we had to rely on other people who had photos to send them in. Which, thank you to our family. I want to thank our family for doing that and for helping out. Like, that was really helpful. Trying to think if there is anything else with that, but that's the full house story. That house was my dad's dream house and he lost it, so they built my mom's dream house. So if you want a house tour of the new house that they built afterwards, what happened, like, I can give that. I probably will, just because after I posted such a dark video, that can probably help, like, with the, you know, getting over things and like moving on, showing how we've come from this and like grown from this, and that like while there are really shitty things that happen and it seems like there is no reason for it, at least like as a family together we pulled through and we're doing good. So yeah, well, thanks for watching. If you have any like similar experiences with whether it's a house burning down or a crazy guy trying to kill you, like you can comment it down below. Like it's really great to see other people who've gone through some just wild scenarios like this, because this was wild. So yeah, thanks for watching and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.